Hello everyone. I hope I am visible and audible both. Yeah. So I am Dr. Resham Basani. I am the educator in the subject of dermatology on an academy. And I'm also a consultant dermatologist practicing at Matunga, Mumbai, and I'm associated with the Wadia Group of Hospitals. I was associated as an assistant professor at the KJ Soumya Medical College for the past 10 years before I joined an academy. So with that introduction, I would like you to know about the plus subscription of an academy. So the plus subscription of an academy has the advantage of giving you daily live classes, structured courses, live tests and quizzes, and an unlimited access to all the content that is there on an academy. Even the lectures which were previously taken up, they are available for your attention. Second is the iconic subscription, which is kind of a combo offer where you get the best of an academy as well as prep ladder. So through an academy, you get the live classes and the batch courses, and through prep ladder, you have the video lectures and the question banks as well as the rapid revision courses. With that, I would also like you to get introduced about the upcoming batches. The upcoming batches are So there is a target NEXT 2022 batch which starts on from 25th of February, that is today, and it will go on up to 11th of August. There will be live interactive classes with the top educators with in-depth subject-wise discussion. The second is okay. Apart from that, what I would also like you to know is about the target NEXT 2022 batch, which will start off from 1st of March and will go on up to 11th of August. The second batch is the last mile to crack NEET BG, which again starts on 1st of March and will go up to 31st of March. There is a focused target batch for INICET 2021, starts from 1st of March and will go on up to 30th of April. And there are free grand tests which starts from 7th of March. It happens at 10 a.m. every day. Okay, so you will have even doubt clearing sessions on those tests. Okay, so now let's go on to the topic that we are going to discuss today. The topic that we are going to discuss today are the must-know images in papillosquamous disorders. So let's go to the first image. This is my the previous recordings of my classes that have already happened in this session are the ones which I enlisted today. Okay, now let's go to the first question. Identify the clinical sign in the given image. Okay, is it the Grattach test, Auschwitz sign, Voronoff's ring, or the bull's eye sign? Can someone write it in the chat box? What do you think is the answer to this question? Look at the image very carefully and you need to tell me the answer. Anyone? Good evening, Amit. Amit says that the answer is C. Yes, Amit, you are completely correct. Yes, it is the Voronoff's ring. So basically, as you can see, there is a ring of hypopigmentation. Okay, this ring of hypopigmentation, which is surrounding the patch of psoriasis, is called as the Voronoff's ring. And this Voronoff's ring occurs because of the release of prostaglandins, okay, which causes this hypopigmentation. Okay, now Grattach test is also seen in patients with psoriasis. See, what actually happens in psoriasis, if you see histopathologically, is that there is parakeratosis, which is equivalent to the clinical appearance of scaling. Okay, in addition to parakeratosis, there is supra papillary thinning of the epidermis, which occurs because of the absence or decrease in the thickness of the granular layer, as well as because of the elongation of the reterages. Okay, so there is regular elongation of the reterages which happens in psoriasis. So because of these reasons, when you try and scrape the lesion of psoriasis, the scales, they kind of come together like a tallow wax candle, okay, and then they are removed. So that is called as the Grattage test in psoriasis. When you perform the Grattage test, you will get exposed to a membrane which is called as the membrane of Bulkley. Now when you go through this membrane of Bulkley, you will see the presence of pinpoint hemorrhages. Okay, so these pinpoint hemorrhages are suggesting the Auschwitz sign. So what you need to remember is that Auschwitz sign in patients with psoriasis occurs due to two reasons. One, there is parakeratosis, and two, there is suprapapillary thinning of the epidermis. Bullseye sign, bullseye lesions basically are nothing but the target lesions, or they are also called as the iris lesions, which are seen in erythema multiforme. So typically these lesions are going to have a central area of dusky erythema, then there is a pale ring of edema, and third there is a ring of erythema. Okay, so that is the bull's eye sign or the bull's eye lesion which you see in patients with erythema multiforme. I hope this is clear. So now let's go to the next question. Now identify this finding in a patient with nail psoriasis. This nail finding occurs due to involvement of what with the psoriatic process? Is it the nail plate? Is it the nail bed? Is it the nail matrix? Or is it the nail fold? Amit, I did not understand. Option D for chloroquine, I did not understand. Can you please elaborate? What are you trying to ask me? First of all, if you look at the picture that you can see, this picture is basically showing you the presence of onycholysis. So what is onycholysis? Onycholysis happens in psoriasis because of the detachment of the nail plate from the nail bed. Okay, so in patients with psoriasis, when there is involvement of the nail bed, there is presence of subungual hyperkeratosis which causes onycholysis. Oh, Amit Dhama, that is bullseye retinopathy which happens in chloroquine toxicity, right? So bullseye retinopathy, if they have mentioned, yes, it goes in favor of chloroquine as the cause, but bullseye lesions are seen in patients with erythema multiforme. I hope that's clear. Okay, now so I was to this second question. The answer, as I mentioned, to this second question is basically the involvement of the nail bed. So involvement of the nail bed in psoriasis causes the presence of subungual hyperkeratosis with the presence of onycholysis. Onycholysis is the detachment of the nail plate from the nail bed. Okay, so I hope this question is clear. So let's go to first nail psoriasis. Nail psoriasis occurs in around 10 to 80% of the patients with psoriasis. Now, if they ask you what is the most common manifestation of nail psoriasis, then it is nail pitting. Remember, nail pitting can be seen in a number of dermatological disorders. You can see it as a part of nail psoriasis. You can also see it in patients with eczema. You can also see it in patients with nail lichen planus, as well as it is seen with alopecia areata. So more common causes of nail pitting include nail psoriasis and nail lichen planus, and nail alopecia areata. So how do you differentiate between nail psoriasis versus alopecia areata involving the nail? So the first point of difference is that in nail psoriasis, the pits, they are deeper, while in alopecia areata, the pits are more superficial. So basically what you need to understand here, that in nail psoriasis, the pits are not only deeper, but they are deeper as well as they are irregularly placed. While in alopecia areata, you see that the pits are superficial and they are very regularly placed. So that is why the pitting in patients with alopecia areata is called as the scotch plate pattern, while for pitting in nail psoriasis, it is called as the thimble pattern. Okay, and remember, the pitting that happens in nail psoriasis is due to involvement of the proximal nail plate. Okay, in eczema also there is nail pitting, but the difference is that in eczema the nail pitting is going to be irregular and it is going to be localized. In addition to that, you can see in this picture that apart from the pitting that you can see here, you can see that there is onycholysis. Okay, you can see that there is onycholysis, means there is separation of the nail plate from the nail bed. There is a yellowish discoloration of the nail, and here you can see there is onychomydesis. So what is onychomydesis? So proximal separation of the nail plate from the nail bed is called as onychomydesis. Okay, here you can see that there is also onychodystrophy in the form of the texture and the architecture of the nail plate is damaged here. Okay, so these are the nail changes of psoriasis. You see nail pitting, there is onycholysis, there can be yellowish discoloration, there can be onychomydesis, there can be onychodystrophy. This is the most specific sign of nail psoriasis. So this sign is called as the oil drop sign. Okay, so basically what you see in the oil drop sign, you will see that there are translucent yellow red discolorations in the nail bed resembling a drop of oil under the nail bed, and this is pathognomic for nail psoriasis. Okay, so remember, oil drop sign is seen in nail psoriasis. Dinesh Joshi, homeopathy medicines do not have a very great effect in psoriasis. Allopathy does have a lot of recent advances in the treatment of psoriasis. If you are concerned about your son, kindly see a qualified allopathic dermatologist who has good experience in treating psoriasis. Okay, so remember, the most specific sign for oil drop is called as the oil drop sign or the salmon patch in nail psoriasis. This is what is showing you subungual hyperkeratosis. Okay, so this is subungual hyperkeratosis, means this is the nail plate. Below the nail plate, there is accumulation of keratinous material, and that is called as subungual hyperkeratosis. So when there is subungual hyperkeratosis, you can see that there is dissociation of the nail plate from the underlying nail bed, leading to onycholysis. Okay, so subungual hyperkeratosis is what is seen in patients with nail psoriasis. There is no tunneling. Okay, now why do we need to differentiate here is because the subungual hyperkeratosis is also seen in patients with dermatophytosis. Okay, so dermatophytosis and psoriasis may be confusing, and hence the way to differentiate is that in patients with dermatophytosis, you will see that there will be associated tunneling because the fungus is trying to go deeper inside the nail, while in patients with psoriasis there will be no tunneling. Okay, so that is one important condition that you need to remember. So onycholysis, as we discussed in the previous MCQ, as you can see in this picture, it's secondary to subungual hyperkeratosis. Let's go to the next question. Now you look at the picture very carefully and you need to tell me, what is this nail change classical feature of? Is it nail psoriasis? Is it nail lichen planus? Is it alopecia areata? Or is it Danios disease? Anyone? What do you think is the answer? Look at the image very carefully. To give you a clue, I'll just make you understand. See, this is the proximal nail fold, and from the proximal nail fold you can see kind of a wing shaped extension which is attaching itself to the distal nail fold, and in that process it is causing a lot of scarring, of the permanent scarring of the nail bed. Okay, so Amit Dhama says the answer is B, and he is absolutely right. It is a patient having nail lichen planus, and what you see here is the classical pterygium. Okay, so classical pterygium is the wing shaped extension of the proximal nail fold causing the scarring of the nail plate and then attaching itself to the distal end of the nail fold. In addition to what you can see here, the pterygium, you can see that the entire nail plate is quite thinned out. So thinning of the nail, in fact, is the most common presentation of nail lichen planus. So the most common presentation of nail lichen planus is thinning of the nail plate. Most specific manifestation of nail lichen planus is the formation of pterygium. Okay, so that is nail lichen planus. Nail psoriasis, as I mentioned to you earlier, the changes, most classical change is the presence of the oil drop sign, and the most common change is pitting. And in addition, there can be certain other changes, like you can see presence of onycholysis, you can see subungual hyperkeratosis. Okay, in alopecia areata you are going to see the scotch blade pattern of pitting of the nails. In Darius disease, typically you see a V-shaped nicking of the nail plate. Along with that, there will be presence of red and white longitudinal bands. Okay, so these are the nail changes in the different dermatological disorders. This is nail lichen planus, a very classical picture where you can see that this is the proximal nail fold, and through the proximal nail fold it is getting attached to the distal nail fold. Okay, so this is nail lichen planus with a typical pterygium formation. Nail lichen planus occurs in 10% of the patients. Thinning of the nail plate is the most common finding of nail lichen planus. Other findings include longitudinal ridging and subungual hyperkeratosis. Dorsal pterygium is the most classical feature of nail lichen planus. This is a dermatoscopic or onychoscopic view showing you this beautiful nail, extension from the proximal nail plate going onto the nail bed. And as you can see, there is complete loss of the nail in this case. So remember, nail lichen planus, when you see the appearance of pterygium, it is something that is permanent. You cannot cure it. Okay. And this is kind of a nail emergency, because when you see lichen planus of the nails, there is a chance that there may be permanent scarring and loss of nails. So you need to treat the patient more aggressively as regards to the nail involvement. Also, there is a sign which is seen in patients with nail lichen planus that is called as the pup tent sign. So what is the pup tent sign? It says that whenever there is a papule of papule on the bed or on the nail bed, what you will see is that the nail plate will get kind of elevated in the form of a tent. Okay, so that is called as the pup tent sign, which you see in cases of nail lichen planus. Okay, now let's go to the next question. Identify the characteristic scale in the image provided. This scaling is seen in which of the following disorders? Do you see it in pityriasis versicolor, in patients with psoriasis, or do you see it in pityriasis rosea? Anyone can write it in the chat box. Look at the picture. They have given you a very, very classical scale there. It's a lesion which is annular with a typical scale. Can anyone write it in the chat box? What do they think is the answer? Yes, Amit, you are completely right. It is a case of pityriasis rosea, and the typical scale that you see in patients with pityriasis rosea is the collarette scale. Why collarette? Because the scale is attached only onto the periphery, okay, like a collar. Okay, so that is why it's called as the collarette scale. Apart from that, what you need to remember is that pityriasis versicolor is also associated with scaling, and the classical scales associated with pityriasis versicolor are described as fine, brany or perforaceous scales. Okay. Second thing is, in patients with psoriasis, the kind of scales that you see are the silvery white micaceous scales. In pityriasis rosea, there are collarette scales. In seborrheic dermatitis, there are yellow or they are yellow greasy scales, okay, in seborrheic dermatitis. Then in patients with pityriasis alba also you have fine scaling, okay. Also in the typical kind of scale which is described in pemphigus foliaceus is leaf like scales, okay. So that is why it comes from the words foliage. Foliage means leaves. Okay, so leaf-like scales are seen in patients with pemphigus foliaceus. Okay, so what is pityriasis rosea? Pityriasis rosea, it's a viral infection which is caused by the HHV-7 more than HHV-6. That is human herpes virus 7 more than human herpes virus 6. Now, there are certain causes of pityriasis rosea which are drug-induced. Okay, so drug-induced causes you can remember by the mnemonic ABGHIM. Okay, ABG stands for A for ACE inhibitors, B for barbiturates, G for gold or greaseofulvin, H for hydrochlorothiazide, I for imatinib or interferon, and M for metronidazole. So it starts as an oval scaly plaque on the trunk, so that's called as the herald patch or the mother patch, and then there are numerous similar appearing smaller lesions which occur along the lines of cleavage, which give rise to a Christmas or a fir tree appearance. Amit Dhama has asked me a very good question. How to differentiate between seborrheic dermatitis and scalp psoriasis? So first of all, seborrheic dermatitis is going to present to you with kind of an aggravated version of dandruff, and it will present as yellowish greasy scaling all through the scalp. Okay, seborrheic dermatitis is going to show a certain seasonal variation, like it will get aggravated in the winters. Okay, and when you treat it, it is amenable to treatment in most of the cases. Scalp psoriasis, on the other hand, will typically have micaceous silvery white scales, which will be firmly adherent. It is kind of more perennial. Of course, it can also have a winter exacerbation. But one difference is that seborrheic dermatitis will not come beyond the hairline, okay, will not go beyond the hairline, while scalp psoriasis typically does cross the hairline and come up onto the skin. So it may come up onto the skin of the forehead, it may come up onto the skin of the nape of the neck, okay. So that is one point of differentiation. And if you are still confused, then what you can go in is for dermatoscopy. Dermatoscopy will show you the typical scales in seborrheic dermatitis, while in scalp psoriasis you will see the whitish appearance of the scales as well as regularly placed dilated blood vessels. And definitely the best way to differentiate the two is by doing a scalp biopsy. Okay, so let's go to pityriasis rosea. As I was discussing, so this patch that you can see in this baby here, this girl here, it's basically the herald patch. Okay, so it's the called as the herald patch because it is the first to come. Okay, it is also called as the mother patch. So following the herald patch, you tend to have multiple, maybe a few weeks after the appearance or few days after the appearance of the herald patch, you have multiple small daughter lesions. Okay, and each daughter lesion is going to be annular in shape with a peripheral collarative scale. If you see the presentation, the typical presentation is on the trunk, and you will see the arrangement in a typical Christmas tree or a fir tree appearance. Okay, so the collarette scales are attached on the outer border and they are free on the inner border of the lesions. When stretched along the long axis, the scales tend to fold across the lines of stretch, and that is called as the hanging curtain sign. So remember, hanging curtain sign is what you see in pityriasis rosea. Pityriasis rosea is a self-resolving condition unless the patient is very, very symptomatic in terms of pruritus, or if the lesions are very, very persistent. Only for these two situations you would need treatment. Otherwise, you just need to give conservative treatment in the form of emollients, oral antihistamines if necessary, and if the lesions are very, very inflamed, on the inflamed lesions one can give a short course of topical corticosteroids. One can give oral erythromycin because of its anti-inflammatory property in the early stages of the disease. High dose acyclovir can also be given. And if the lesions are quite resistant and long standing, then one can also add on UVB therapy. Okay. Let's go to the last question for the day. Identify the condition in the image and you need to tell me what is the answer. Is it leukoplakia? Is it squamous cell carcinoma? Is it erythroplakia? Or is it oral lichen planus? Look at the image very carefully. You can see that there is the pathology which is happening on the inner aspect of the lip, lower lip. Can anyone tell me the answer, Amit? Yes, Amit, very good. The answer is oral lichen planus, and here you can see that there is this lace-like pattern or reticular pattern of oral lichen planus, which is the most common variant of oral lichen planus. Yes, so lace-like or reticulate pattern is the most common pattern of oral lichen planus. Okay, erythroplakia will look typically as a red patch. Squamous cell carcinoma can be ulcerative or fungating. And leukoplakia will present as a white patch in the oral cavity, right? So now what you need to remember specifically about oral lichen planus is that the most common variant of oral lichen planus is the reticular variant. There are other variants which, like for example, erosive variant of lichen planus. Remember, erosive variant of lichen planus has a low risk of conversion into malignancy. So if you see the conditions which are having a pre-malignant potential, there is very high risk of 70 to 85% seen in erythroplakia. There is a high risk of 10 to 30% which you see in leukoplakia of the non-homogeneous type, actinic chylitis and submucous fibrosis, and low risk of malignancy is seen in leukoplakia of the homogeneous type or oral erosive lichen planus. So please remember this table. It's extremely important. Questions have been asked on this at varying times. So very high risk erythroplakia, high risk for leukoplakia non-homogeneous, actinic chylitis and submucous fibrosis, and low risk for leukoplakia which is homogeneous and oral erosive lichen planus. So if they ask you what is the most common premalignant lesion in the oral cavity, it is leukoplakia. Okay. Now identify this variant of psoriasis on the basis of this picture. Is it chronic plaque type psoriasis? Is it flexural psoriasis? Is it guttate psoriasis? Or is it pustular psoriasis? We have just a minute more. Can somebody answer quickly? Okay, since nobody is answering, I will tell you the answer. Yes, Amit, you are right. It is pustular psoriasis. So basically what you need to remember here is that there are these pustules which are present over an erythematous base, and these pustules, they are kind of coalescing together, and they are coalescing together so as to form lakes of pus. So this appearance of lakes of pus is something that is very, very classically seen in patients with pustular psoriasis, and hence the answer here is pustular psoriasis. Okay, so that's the time we have today. Tomorrow we have another session, same time, between 4:30 to 5. And tomorrow we'll be discussing the must-know images in vesiculobulous disorders. So be there tomorrow. Thank you today for a very patient listening. Bye.